In 1816, our planet experienced one of the earliest recorded instances of global climate change. It all started with the 1815 eruption of Indonesia's Mount Tambora, which spurred droughts and crop failures, altered weather systems, triggered disease, and destabilized regimes. So, today we're going to take a look at why 1816 is known as the Year Without a Summer. But before we get started, be sure to subscribe to the Weird History Channel and let us know in the comments below what other historical disasters you would like to hear about.
Okay, let's take a look at this historical bummer of a summer, bro.
Mount Tambora, also known as Tamboro, is located in West Nusa Tenggara, in the northern part of Sumbawa, on one of the lesser Sunda Islands of Indonesia. Its 1815 eruption is the largest recorded volcanic eruption in human history, with some scientists believing it to be 4 to 10 times as mighty as the eruption of Krakatoa in 1883. In the aftermath, the world faced one of its most significant and challenging geological events. However, a while passed before the world felt Tambora's effect. During this time, Europe was reeling from the Napoleonic Wars. The United States was constructing a new nation, and the Chinese Qing Dynasty was pursuing an aggressive resettlement plan. As the enormous ash plume made its way across the world, it put additional pressure on all of these situations and wreaked havoc on entire communities. The event began with an initial eruption on April 5, 1815. Despite its moderate size, this first eruption was accompanied by a detonation sound so loud it could be heard nearly 900 miles away. The following day, volcanic ash began to fall in Java, and additional eruptive noises, similar to the sound of guns being fired, could be heard a full 1,600 miles away on Sumatra. By that night, columns of flame rose into the sky, and Mount Tambora itself was covered by fire. Pumice rained down from the sky, and lava flowed down all sides of the volcano to the sea, completely destroying the village of Tambora. Analysts disagree on an exact number of lives lost due to Mount Tambora's eruption. However, even the most conservative estimates suggest around 10,000 people perished from pyroclastic flows during the initial eruption, and another 70,000 passed in the subsequent months from disease and hunger. To drive home the fact that the eruption was the largest volcanic event in modern history, the 1815 burst garnered a volcanic explosivity index of 7 on a scale that goes up to 8. Spinal Tap would be mildly impressed. In modern times, we're constantly hearing about and indeed beginning to see the effects of global warming. But back in 1816, the eruption of Mount Tambora caused a similarly troublesome bout of global cooling to the tune of 3 degrees. Though a 3-degree temperature drop may not sound particularly profound, this change in weather actually had wide-reaching consequences. The ash cloud generated by the volcano made its way to the stratosphere, reflecting incoming sunlight and cooling the Earth. The wind disrupted weather systems and increased rainfall across much of the northern hemisphere. Europe, China, and even North America all experienced below-average temperatures that year, and entire harvests were ruined. Switzerland saw an ice dam form in the middle of the summer, and China and India documented disruptions to the monsoons which caused flooding. As regular viewers of Weird History might know from our 2020 video on a timeline of the potato famine that changed Ireland forever, the most widely known Irish potato famine occurred between 1845 and 1849. However, many primary sources insist a different series of potato famines affected the country in the 18th and 19th centuries. These earlier famines are believed to be caused by Mount Tambora's eruption, which caused an 8-week-long rainy period in Ireland. As a result, local crops failed and famine ensued, leading to a typhus epidemic from 1816 to 1819. Roughly 100,000 people perished. The eruption of Mount Tambora didn't just bring killer famines in its wake. To everyone's surprise, and probably no one's joy, it also led to a new strain of cholera. This more deadly form of the disease had mutated due to the Bay of Bengal's altered weather patterns and the chemical changes in the soil. The population couldn't fight the microbe that targeted the immune system, and the sickness quickly traveled all over Asia. By the century's end, the entire world felt cholera's effects. While the exact number of people who died from the new cholera isn't known, It easily claimed the lives of millions. At the height of his power, Napoleon Bonaparte seemed unstoppable. He cut a swath across Europe, and until his defeat at Waterloo, which we also covered in a video, he held brief dominion over most of the continent. But as bad as Napoleon's conquest was, the eruption of Mount Tambora proved even more disruptive to Europe. The eruption caused ash, rain, and freezing temperatures to circulate throughout the continent. Hardly anyone was prepared for these effects, and food stores were low. As the strife disrupted agricultural processes, many European nations found themselves having to rely on American imports to avoid widespread starvation. While the eruption affected people globally, the most dramatic consequences occurred closer to the volcano. For instance, the annual Indian monsoon slowed down, leading to a dizzying array of effects like the aforementioned cholera epidemic that started in Bengal. Mount Tambora also emitted a substantial amount of sulfate. According to historian Gillan Darcy Wood, the massive load of sulfate gases Tambora injected into the stratosphere produced an aerial dust cloud consisting of up to 100 cubic kilometers of debris. This great sun-obscuring plume then circled the Earth at the equator in a matter of weeks before drifting poleward. He also said that this plume would have played havoc with the world's major weather systems for almost 3 years. Interestingly, one place the volcano failed to affect a massive drop in temperature was in the Arctic. In fact, a strange conflux ended up forcing warm winds northward. Arctic ice melted and formed new pathways into the uncharted frozen landscape. The British Navy, hoping to find a northern passage, prepared multiple Arctic expeditions. Taking advantage of the shifting weather patterns to cut through the frozen territory no one had previously been able to navigate does sound like a great idea. But it didn't quite work out. The first of these expeditions, launched in 1818 and headed by Captain John Ross, arrived in the north only to find that weather patterns had stabilized and their potential path had disappeared. However, in the following years, British explorers and other nations continued to launch Arctic journeys. Like most of the world, China's Yunnan province faced extreme consequences because of the Mount Tambora effect. Unseasonable cold weather and rain disrupted the annual rice crop, and desperate farmers turned to poppies, a more reliable crop that, as most people know, is chiefly used to produce opium. As one of the defining economic conflicts of the 1800s, the Chinese opium trade resulted in major rebellions that took thousands of lives. It also birthed the modern golden triangle of heroin production in Southeast Asia. While scholars have yet to concretely prove that Thomas Jefferson had realized a commonality between the collapse of his crops and the eruption at Mount Tambora, he certainly felt the volcano's effects. In 1816, Jefferson had retired from the presidency and taken to farming in Monticello. Newspapers from that year report that on account of the cold weather, most farmers in Virginia were facing crops that were one-half to two-thirds short. And Jefferson's harvest was no exception. Like many farmers in the United States, Jefferson is known to have faced deep financial peril in the year without a summer. In fact, his failed wheat crops compelled him to apply for a loan to make ends meet. The effects of the eruption weren't all bad. In fact, from the point of view of literary horror fans, the eruption helped birth one of the all-time greatest works of genre fiction. You see, in the summer of 1816, Mary Godwin and her soon-to-be husband, Percy Shelley, traveled with a few close friends to Lake Geneva for vacation. When the bad weather, a direct result of the eruption at Mount Tambora, trapped them indoors, they spent their time sharing ghost stories. Lord Byron challenged Mary to tell a scary ghost story. She demurred. Later that night, she couldn't sleep and received a vision that she later described in writing. According to the author herself, "I saw with shut eyes, but acute mental vision. I saw the pallow student of unhallowed arts kneeling beside the thing he had put together. I saw the hideous phantasm of a man stretched out, and then, on the working of some powerful engine, show signs of life." Mary's vision prompted her to compose the novel Frankenstein, which still stands today as one of the most famous books ever written. Worth mentioning is that while Mary may have won the scary story contest, don't feel bad for Lord Byron. His relatively short entry was called The Vampire. And today it's widely considered to be the first story in the now wildly popular genre about romantic vampires. Everything from Dracula to Twilight owes its existence to Byron's vampire. So you could say if it wouldn't have been for a year without a summer, we wouldn't have Frankenstein or Dracula. While Mary Shelley was making literary history, things weren't going quite as well for everyone else in the arts. In fact, brilliant young composer Franz Schubert was facing more than a few challenges in 1816. His hero, Goethe, rebuffed him, and he only received one commission the entire year. While that's more than enough reason for him to be bummed out, some music historians believe Schubert's melancholy output was a direct result of seasonal affective disorder, brought on by the dark summer of 1816. That being said, while the unusual weather may have depressed the musician, it certainly didn't slow him down any. During 1816, Schubert composed two symphonies and a variety of other musical works, including chorales, lieder, and chamber music. Planet Earth is home to an estimated 20 active supervolcanoes. These massive magma deposits have incredible capabilities, and some landforms could prove more powerful than Mount Tambora. And while we don't mean to put anyone on edge, it's a fact that most supervolcanoes could erupt at literally any time, without a trigger or earthquake. These lava emissions only occur about once every 100,000 years, and can significantly impact the climate. So there's something to look forward to, I guess. So what do you think? What's the closest volcano to you? Let us know in the comments below, and while you're at it, check out some of these other videos from our weird history.